Good morning, everybody. Welcome. Well done for making it in the middle of January when it's freezing cold out there. And in here, well done. Thank you. You have made the right choice in coming to worship God. And hello to everybody on the camera who's watching online later. It's good for us to be together, to join in our worship of God. And I'm going to invite you to stand in a moment, and we'll sing as ever. In fact, why don't we do that now? If you're able and you would like to, please stand, and we'll pray. And then we'll sing in praise of God. Father God, thank you so much for life. Thank you for creating us. Thank you for giving us life and strength. Thank you for sending Jesus into the world to save and rescue us and to be one of us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are with us. Send your Holy Spirit, Lord, on us now, that as we worship you, as we turn our heart and our mind and all our thinking and all our feeling to you, Lord, please meet with us. Please come by your Spirit. Restore us and renew us and empower us. Inhabit our praises, Lord. And may we know that you are God indeed this day. Help us, Lord, to worship you now. Thank you, Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit. Amen.
My soul, the King of Heaven, to his feet thy tribute bring. Ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven, evermore his praises sing.
I cast my mind to to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all
stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whispers of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. Searching for answers far and wide, searching for answers, only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all.
Thank you, Lord, for that amazing reality that you are with us and you love us. You know all about us, Lord, and you know our faults and failings. You know our troubles and strife and grief, and you love us in the middle of it. Thank you, Lord, for being with us now. Bless us as we read your word and think about it. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Please have a seat. I've got some readings, and in all the excitement of this morning, I haven't asked anyone to do them, so I'll just crack on with them. The first is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 62, verses 1 to 5. There we are. We looked at some words from Isaiah last week. This is a chapter or two further on. More amazing words foretelling what God is doing. Explaining God's promises. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not be quiet, until her righteousness goes forth as brightness, and her salvation as a burning torch. The nations shall see your righteousness, and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no more be termed forsaken, and your land shall no more be termed desolate, but you shall be called, "My delight is in her," and your land, "Married." For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your sons marry you, And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. And we have another reading. You might begin to discern the theme in here. This is from John chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. On the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus also was invited to the wedding with his disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does that have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now there were six stone water jars there for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them. They filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast." So they took it. When the master of the feast tasted the water, now become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when the people have drunk freely, then the poor wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." This, the first of his signs, Jesus did at Cana in Galilee and manifested his glory. And his disciples believed in him. And then one more reading, this time from the end of the New Testament, Revelation chapter 21, a beautiful vision of what is to come. Revelation 21, 1 to 7. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning or crying or pain anymore, because the former things have passed away.' And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new.' Also he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' And he said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, I wonder, listening to that second Bible reading, were you surprised to find that one of the very first things that John recorded Jesus as doing is miraculously providing some fantastically generous quantities of top quality wine for a wedding reception? If you had predicted Jesus's first miracle, would that have been it? Last week we thought about the revelation, the epiphany, the appearing of Jesus to the whole world. "Your light has come," the Bible says. And Jesus is the light who, when we trust and work with him, makes us to be light with him. And John says that this extraordinary story of what Jesus did at Cana in Galilee was the first of his signs, and that it manifested, that means showed or displayed or made blindingly obvious, his glory. And this, like the rest of Jesus' story, the epiphany, the great revelation of God, this is it continuing. All that happened, and what was the response? Well, John says, his disciples believed in him. They trusted him. Now, Jesus in his day was accused of partying too much and hanging out with all the wrong people. And the truth is that he did hang out with all kinds of people. No matter what their circumstances, there were several rum characters who were part of his disciples and his friends, the people that he knew and loved. But everything Jesus did, he did for a purpose. He knew weddings are significant and wonderful times. And he made sure that this wedding went very well indeed. And weddings are a theme in the Bible. The Bible starts, you might remember, with the story of a wedding, near enough anyway. Genesis chapter 2, there is the story of Adam and Eve. God created the universe, made the heavens and the earth, and finally he made us two human beings and declared it very good. And Adam and Eve, it says in Genesis, were made for each other. A man and a woman coming together to symbolize, to recreate the very image of God himself. So whenever a man and a woman choose to and vow to undertake the way of life we know as Christian marriage, we know that they are fulfilling one of the most basic and wonderful plans that God has for us, the people he created. We're made for each other. Together, two become one, and at our best, our marriages are a reflection of the glory of God himself. And the Bible ends with a wedding as well. In the book of Revelation, we heard the promise that one day God is going to establish a new heaven, new heavens and new earth. And on that day, when it happens, there's going to be one huge wedding celebration. Only this wedding will be different. It will mark God himself finally being reunited with us, his people. And the way it's described is beautiful. Those words are touching and they speak to deep into our hearts. The dwelling of God is with men, with people, and he will live with them. They will be his people. God himself will be with them and their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain because the old order of things has passed away. Those are tremendous words. And I know they mean a lot to people here today. But behind that promised wedding celebration, there hangs an implication, and it's something we know all too well. The implication is that somehow things have gone wrong and need to be restored. The implication is that life is tough, that our marriages can fail, that we, the human race, have some fatal flaws in us. And the Bible says the problem started way back in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. They were tricked into not trusting God and into doing things their own way. They very quickly found they could no longer live and love the way they had been meant to. And that was when the death and the mourning and the crying and the pain first began. And ever since, it's been the same for all of us. We want to love and be loved, but time and again, we find it to be a struggle. We find that things go wrong in us and in our world. And one consequence is that there are times in every marriage where the love and commitment expressed every wedding day are sorely tested. And of course, all of us, married and single alike, go through ups and downs, highs and lows, great joys and great sorrows. We're all tested and troubled one way or another, sooner or later. We all have to sort out our lives and find answers to the problems of how to live well, how to be good people, even as the world around us continues in endlessly wicked ways. So, it's not just helpful, it's actually vital that we remember the answer to all our questions and all our problems which came to light 2,000 years ago when Jesus gatecrashed, not just that wedding in Cana, but gatecrashed the whole of human history, our marriages and our lives included. It wasn't just marriages, human marriages, that Jesus came to save and sort out. Even more importantly, he came to save and sort out the relationship between us and God. When Adam and Eve were deceived into choosing their own ways over God's, it wasn't just their own relationship that went wrong. The very first breakage came between them and the God who so lovingly created them and had been providing for them. It's in Genesis 3. After they rebelled, God came to see them, came to be with them again that evening, but then they hid themselves from the presence of God. "Where are you?" God asked. And then he explained the consequences of what their break in trust meant. It meant trouble and pain and strife. And it's probably fair to say that the rest of the Bible from then on sets out both the consequences of what has gone wrong because that relationship was broken, along with the efforts God makes to restore that broken relationship. Time and again, God points out what is wrong and asks his people to come back to him. Time and again, we refuse, stuck in the darkness and the mourning and the pain. And like Adam and Eve, we blame each other. The rest of Genesis tells lots of stories about how God was faithful to lead and support a bunch of people who were very often rebellious against him and his ways. Exodus tells about the great rescue God engineered through Moses to get his people out of slavery in Egypt and into a good land that he had promised to them. He gave them laws and distinct ways of doing things to help them. And again, and in Deuteronomy comes a statement of the deal. God says, "Keep rebelling against my ways, and this is what it's going to be like. But if you follow me and my ways, you will be blessed beyond your imagining." Nevertheless, we kept choosing separation, and we kept choosing trouble, avoiding the good things that we needed to do. This all led to a succession of leaders, some who did well and some who were just awful. A great king, David, was raised up, and even with his flaws, did much that was good, but not too long after him, the trouble won out again, and God's people were divided and sent into exile. Even in those troubled times, the prophets came along and started speaking out the same message from God. Go your own way, and as you see, things will go badly. Come back to God, and things will go well. And it's interesting, I think, that marriage is one of the ways to express this that God and the biblical writers come back to over and over again, the marriage covenant. In the Old Testament book of his name, the prophet Hosea uses marriage to someone horribly unfaithful to try and get the point across. You can read this later. But be warned, he uses what is sometimes horrific and shocking language to say just how bad and evil the separation from God makes us. Then, in contrast, there's a book called the Song of Songs, or the Song of Solomon. It comes before Isaiah in the Bible. Again, you can read this later. And that contains the most beautiful expression of a man and woman's love. And implicit throughout is what the Church of England's marriage service rather coyly calls the delight and tenderness of sexual union. It's an amazing book to find in the Bible. It's beautiful and powerful. And then, of course, today's reading from Isaiah reiterates the idea and language of marriage to express what God wants to restore between him and all of his people. And again, the language is wonderful. Hear these words as spoken to you by the prophet Isaiah and fulfilled in Jesus today. you shall no more be termed forsaken. Your land shall no more be called desolate, but you shall be called, my delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your sons marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. This happens over and over again in the Bible. Yes, a young man marrying a young woman is meant to be a wonderful thing. We can be sure of that. But even more wonderful, whether we're married to another human being or not, is the connection. Restoring, renewing that connection between us and God. It's the connection between us and God that matters the most. Everyone is meant to be in on this. Look at the Revelation reading again. Or on the one hand, with the bride of Christ, the people made ready for the bridegroom, Jesus. Revelation says, I saw the holy city coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And on the other hand, we're all sons of God, his inheritors. The one who conquers will have this heritage. And I will be his God, and he will be my son. The important thing to note is that God loves us so passionately and so fully. He hates all that has gone wrong and the mess we are so often in, but he cannot stop loving us, and he is longing to restore us to him. You might even say he's dying to restore us to himself. So as we think about that wedding party at Cana and Jesus turning the water into the wine, let's remember how the rest of the story unfolds. From the heights and the joys of that wedding party, Jesus went down to the depths. He suffered the very worst this broken world has to offer: betrayal, physical pain, mental anguish, and death. But when he died on that cross, he made our place. He made the place where all our failure and pain, all our sin and its effects, can be transformed. On the cross, the wine he provided so abundantly and so generously was his own blood. It was poured out so we can be forgiven and we can forgive each other. It was poured out so we can be washed clean and made new. It was poured out so that we can be reconciled to God, to know him and love him passionately and fully. Right now and forever. Remember also that when from those terrible depths Jesus rose up physically from the dead, that first Easter Sunday, the power he displayed so abundantly was the love with which God goes on loving us, never ending, better than anything we could imagine for ourselves, working in us in this life and the next. The Spirit which raised Jesus from the dead is the same Spirit that can fill and empower us every day, every moment. God never abandons us. He's done what it takes for us to be with him forever. That story, those truths are the most important truths for and about the human race. Our marriages, our singleness, our relationships, our friendships, our family, our church family. These are all good and God-given things. But the relationship with God that Jesus has won back for us is the foundation beneath them all. If we do not have that foundation in place, the weight we will try and put on all these other relationships will always be too much. You may remember me saying this quote before from Tim Keller, the American preacher. He says this: the only love that won't disappoint you is one that can't change and that can't be lost. One that is not based on the ups and downs of life or how well you live and perform. It is something that not even death can take away from you. God's love is the only thing like that. It's important to know that it's being reunited with God through Jesus into that kind of relationship which will enable you to fulfill not just marriage vows, but all the good ways of life God means for us and by which we can live well, starting now and going into eternity. So, how do we respond to that? How do we respond to that today, here and now? I think it begins with a step of trust, one step. A willingness to trust Jesus in this moment, to trust him no matter what the blast and the storm around us might be right now. There may be a hurricane hurling everything at you right now. There may be depths of pain which seem so dark and still and unfathomable. Or you may be even quite content with yourself in what seems to be the worldly success that's come your way on your terms. Because of Jesus, we can now choose something different to what Adam and Eve and everyone since first chose. We can choose God and this fierce, great love for us, knowing that our sin and pain is covered and that it can be forgiven and all its effects can be healed. John says the response to Jesus and that first miracle in Cana was that his disciples believed in him. They chose to walk with him, to grow in trust and confidence of him. And that's what faith is. It's trust and confidence in this God. Slowly but surely, they got to know him. They learned from him, sometimes in hard and difficult ways. And then after he died and he rose, they were filled with his spirit and they brought him to others, both at home and to the ends of the earth. And that restored relationship between his friends and Jesus, between them and God, that restored relationship made all the difference to their lives. There is a pretty strong argument for saying that the person who followed and knew Jesus most closely was his mother, Mary. Long before the rest, she knew the best thing possible was to point people to her amazing son. So to finish, I just want to point out again the best piece of advice which I can possibly give anyone here today. I can't presume to do much more. It's the same advice which came from Jesus' mother, Mary, that day. She simply pointed to Jesus and said, "Do whatever he tells you. Do whatever Jesus tells you." We probably know the right next step in our hearts. If we're unsure, We can read more about Jesus. We can find out God's ways and God's laws. And we can choose that we want to do that. But the most important thing is to do that with Jesus. Knowing his love, knowing his presence, knowing his forgiveness, knowing his help, knowing his healing. That's what makes it all possible. Without that, it'll just be stumbling around and trying in our own strength to do what we cannot do. Grace is God doing for us what we cannot do in our own strength. What is the step of obedience that you can take in the direction of this Jesus who loves you today? Let's pray together. Too much, some of you may be thinking, too religious, too much of a threat to what I think I have to rely on right here and now. Well, remember how meeting Jesus and seeing him, knowing him, led his friends to trust him and follow him, and led to his mother saying, "This guy is so amazing, do whatever he tells you." None of the good things God gives us can bear our weight unless he first loves and supports us. We don't have to go on in loneliness or darkness or doubt or despair. We can claim this promise today. Your light has come. Your light has come. Just drink in those words again. You shall no more be termed forsaken. Your land shall no more be termed desolate. You shall be called my delight is in her, and your land married, because the Lord delights in you. Your land shall be married. As a young man marries a young woman, so shall your sons marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, that is exactly how God rejoices over you right here, right now. So, Lord, thank you. As we receive this amazing truth, as we begin to accept the love that you have for us, speak to us right here and now and in the days ahead. Speak to us to restore us fully to all the love and purpose and plans you have for us. Forgive us and heal us, so that we can indeed do whatever good things you tell us. And maybe this is a moment just to come to God with things that need forgiving. If there's something playing on your conscience or in your heart and mind, something recent or something that's been there for a long, long time, just say, "Lord, I'm sorry. I want to do things differently now. I choose to stop rebelling and to start doing things your way." Be sure that even before the words are completely out of your mouth, Jesus from the cross is saying, "You are forgiven. You are set free." Or maybe you've been hurt by things other people have done, or circumstances that have spoilt, ruined, turned your life upside down, battered you. Because Jesus forgives us, we have the strength to forgive others, even to forgive circumstances too. With Jesus next to you, with his arm around you, choose to forgive people who have let you down or disappeared, or whatever circumstances have caused you great grief and pain. Bible tries to get the message across to us in so many different ways. We are like a bride being prepared for the bridegroom. Jesus' people getting ready to be united with him more fully and completely than ever. We're sons of the living God, adopted into his family with great joy. As you receive forgiveness and as you receive healing, stand as who you really are. A much-loved son and daughter of God, loved beyond imagining and ready to obey and follow where Jesus leads. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for being a mighty, loving Savior. We need your grace, we need your love. Pour it out on us, Lord, and give us grace to follow you now and forever. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you for sitting through all of that. Some of that was quite intense, and you may want to talk to somebody and pray with somebody. I'm here, other people are here. Please do talk and ask for prayer. There might be time to do that during communion. There certainly will after the service too. So please, yeah, let's support each other as we do whatever Jesus is telling us and following him together. We're going to share communion now. And as we get ready, we're going to sing another song. So can I invite you to stand? And you'll probably need to stretch and shake a bit after all that sitting down on hard wooden pews. This is a foretaste of the heavenly banquet sometimes. It's cold and it doesn't seem much, and we can't even drink the wine at the moment, but we can receive the bread, Jesus' body, as a living sign, as a reality, the reality of God with us. So prepare to meet with Jesus and worship God as we sing and receive from him now. Let's sing that song. Thanks, Dave.
Make me whole. nothing but the blood of Jesus. All my praise for this I bring, nothing but the blood, nothing but the blood.
Well, here we go. We're going to praise and worship Jesus together and meet with him and just renew that relationship. If you know and love Jesus, if you want to know and love him more, take that next step of confidence and trust and expect that as you come forward at the right moment, you will meet with him in his body, in the bread, and by his spirit. The words will be on screen. Please respond in the green letters. And we're just going to proclaim Jesus' presence here and meet with him. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Almighty God, good Father to us all, your face is turned towards your world. In love, you gave us, Jesus, your Son, to rescue us from sin and death. Your word goes out to call us home to the city where angels sing your praise. We join with them in heaven's song. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Father of all, we give you thanks for every gift that comes from heaven. To the darkness, Jesus came as your light. With signs of faith and words of hope, he touched untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. This is his story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. The crowds came out to see your son, yet at the end, they turned on him. On the night he was betrayed, he came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. This is his story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, "This is my body, given for you all." Jesus then gave thanks for the wine. He took the cup, gave it, and said, "This is my blood, shed for you all, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." This is our story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. Therefore, Father, with this bread, celebrate the cross on which he died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you to plead for us. and all the world. This is our story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. Send your Spirit on us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with opened eyes and hearts on fire. May we and all who share this food offer ourselves to live for you and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Is there a slide before that? Let's say these words together. And honor, and glory, and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. You might like to kneel or sit as together, as our Savior taught us, we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and remember his blood, which he shed for you. Eat in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving.
Trust in Jesus and to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise and to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Cleansing blood and in simple faith to plunge. trust you.
Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for this chance to know that we can trust you. Thank you for this sense of your presence we have. And thank you for the bread, which is your body, so that we know that you are with us now and always. Lord, as we commit our next steps to following you and doing what you tell us, please be with us, guide us, protect us, uphold us. Whatever our circumstances, whatever we're going out to, Lord, help us to know that you are with us in it all. Send us out, Lord, in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Amen. Well, I'm looking for the thing which reminds me some of the things I need to tell you. We're going to pray in a moment. And let's do that now. In fact, let's just, in the presence of God, come to him with the cries of our heart and knowing that when we come to him, this God who loves us so much loves to answer our prayers as well. So let's pray together. Lord, we pray first for the world that needs to know this message of reconciliation and new relationship with you. Lord, instead of being deceived by the enemy into the same old wicked ways, Lord, may the veil be lifted, and may the glory and wonder of who you are be revealed among us and through us. May the world see and hear, and may the world know that you are great and good, and you are worth following, and that you love us so very much. And if there are any places around the world that are on your heart, either right now or regularly, just lift those countries, those places to God again, places where there's war or persecution. Just lift them in your heart. Lord, in your love and mercy, hear our prayer. Let's think of this community, this town where we live, with all its troubles, with all its glories. Pray for your neighbors and friends. Pray for the place where you work or the institutions you visit and everyone in them. Pray for those people you just see going up and down the street who drive past. Pray for Stafford Street. Again, Lord, we ask for the good news about your availability and your love and your rescue to get out to people all around us. As we receive your love, Lord, and as we're changed by it, may others be drawn to your light as well. Not to rules, not to regulations, not to religiosity, Lord, but to you, the living God who loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let's pray for the church. Let's pray for this church. We're going through some difficult times with everyone else. Let's just pray for each other that we'll be faithful in our following of Jesus and do what it takes to support each other in church and outside of it. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And let's just pray for anyone we know who's in distress and who really needs prayers right now. It might be people who are unwell, or it might be people who are grieving the loss of someone they know and love. Let's pray especially for the family and friends of Pete Baker, Tony Swain, and the brother of Pete Richardson, John. Pete Richardson's brother, John. Let's pray for all those people affected, that they may know God's love and peace at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thank you, Lord, that we can look forward with hope and confidence to that great banquet, that day when we are gloriously, fully reunited with you. Thank you for the foretaste of the banquet we've had today, Lord. Be with us and love us now and always. Amen. Amen. Thank you for praying. Some notices. I'm looking at the Blounts at the back. Are you going to the Battelle service on Friday? Do you want to come and tell everyone about it, one of you? One of the able-bodied. It's this Friday, isn't it? And while Carrie's coming down to the front. We're still meeting weekday mornings at 9 for half an hour's worship. So if you're around, some of you may have to go to work or college, but if you're not going to work or college on any given morning, please come and join us, 9 to 9.30, for just an informal time of worship and praise. And of course, we're here on Wednesday mornings at 11 for the traditional service, and we're here back again next Sunday at 10.30. What is happening on Friday? Who can go? Do you want to tell us about it?
I haven't been to a Battelle worship evening for a long time, but I did notice they've got one happening at their new church, which is in Aston, Anchor Point Church. And it's called Release. It's a worship night, and it's on the 21st of January, and I believe it starts at 6:30. It is on Facebook if you've got social media. So have a look for Battelle of Britain on Facebook, and it'll be under there. So it's a night of praise and worship. That's all I know, but they usually are quite good, like sing along at a football match if a loud and noisy worship, and the Spirit of God's usually there.
Yeah, thank you, Carrie. It's a long time since I've been to Battelle worship. And if it's any encouragement in our building struggles, 10 years ago Battelle were talking about getting a new church building, and of course it always takes longer than we think. But they have a new building near Aston. And so if anyone wants to go that, please talk to Carrie or myself. Just go. Just turn up. It'll be worth it. It'll be very encouraging. We're going to sing one more song as we get ready to go. This is a reminder of who we really are as we renew that relationship with God through everything Jesus has done for us. So let's stand and we'll sing together our closing song.
But he brought me in, oh, his love for me, oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free.
In my Father's house, there's a
Just as we go, we need to receive God's blessing, his goodwill, his favor. May the blessing of God be with you. May you know his face shining on you, smiling with delight on you. May you sense his presence all around you, reassuring you and guiding you, helping you to follow in the right ways. This is the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He is with us now and forever. Amen. Amen. We haven't shared the peace with each other, so just turn and wave some of the peace of the Lord. May the peace of the Lord be always with you. And let's share that with each other and support each other in our following of Jesus as we go. Thank you so much for coming today. It's been lovely to share with you. I hope you've met with Jesus and you take him with you as you go. God bless. Bye for now. See you again soon.